to announce Oh My World's Geek of the Month. And my very first guest is Juan Zarate, who's basically a badass who fights crime and who's been doing it for a long time. I know Juan because he was the first ever Assistant Secretary for Terrorist Financing and Financial Crimes at the US Department of the Treasury. So he's the guy who helped lead the team that hunted down Al-Qaeda's money after 9/11. Before that, he was a federal terrorism prosecutor. His last government position was as Deputy Assistant to the President and Deputy National Security Advisor for Combatting Terrorism under the Bush administration. Told you he was a badass. And he's now Global Co-Managing Partner and Chief Strategy Officer at K2 Integrity. You're gonna love Juan, because he's just awesome in general, and he's obviously a glorious geek, but I wanted to bring him on to talk about the importance of financial tools in achieving FOPO goals. For those of you who are new to Oh My World, FOPO stands for foreign policy. And he has an awesome book called Treasury's War, The Unleashing of a New Era of Financial Warfare, where he talks about how the United States used a range of financial measures and sanctions to target thugs and criminals around the world. Hi, Juan. Thank you so much for joining the show. I am so excited to have you. You are the true glorious geek.
Gar, thank you so much. You're a great colleague and a great friend. I'm happy to be your guest geek today.
Oh, well, the pleasure is mine. I am so excited that you're joining at this time because sanctions is always a hot topic. A lot of people talk about it, but a lot of people don't really understand it. And they kind of get a bad rep, right? A lot of people think that sanctions are bad. They just hurt innocent civilians. And you were at the Treasury Department when sanctions and using them in this more targeted fashion really became a thing. So can you talk to us about that and talk to us about, you know, how you see it going overall?
Absolutely, Hagar. I think the simple way of thinking about sanctions is that they fill the middle ground of tools and power that we try to use to influence things around the world. So between diplomacy, talking to actors, and the use of kinetic force, the military, we don't have a lot of tools. And the reality is, over time, predating 9/11, the use of sanctions was really the tool of choice by diplomats, by others, to try to influence what's happening around the world, to punish bad behavior, to influence decision-making, and post 9/11, really to isolate very bad actors that were trying to do damage to the United States and others around the world. And so post 9/11, what we really did was to think through, how do you use sanctions, which is the ability to affect an individual, an entity, a country's ability to access financing, capital, the commercial system. How do you disallow that? How do you isolate them so that that becomes a point of leverage and something other than going to war, and something more than just trying to convince somebody by talking to them? What kind of leverage can you build to change behavior? And frankly, in the post 9/11 context, disrupt and dismantle terrorist groups' ability to attack and do things like 9/11. That's really the bottom line for sanctions. Can you make it harder, costlier, and riskier for terrorist groups, criminals, bad actors from raising and moving money around the world?
Exactly. And, you know, obviously I always tell people I'm a sanctions nerd. People have accused me of
You're a great expert, by the way, not just a nerd.
Thank you. You know, people have said that I haven't met a sanction I didn't like. And that is not true. There are sanctions that I don't love, you know, which kind of gets me to this question about collateral damage. And, you know, there's a lot of folks that say, you know, it's hurting innocent civilians. So do you think that sanctions can be better changed or maneuvered in order to avoid collateral damage on innocent civilians?
Absolutely, Hagar. And I think there's a fair criticism, and this is part of the Biden administration's review of sanctions, and frankly, the discourse on college campuses and in academia around the effective use of sanctions. Sanctions get overused for the same reasons that they're effective. They're often the tool of first choice, right? And you've seen Congress get more involved. There's often a desire to use sanctions in a maximalist way in any crisis. And it's now the first policy instinct when we've got a problem. And that may not be the right answer. And the way you tailor the sanctions has to fit the problem. So I think there are obvious answers. Sanctions have to be in service of a strategy. They can't just be willy-nilly imposed without a sense as to what you're trying to do or how you unwind them. They have to be targeted. You don't want innocent victims or to strangle an economy that may not be effective for your strategy. But I think really, Hagar, and this is something we tried at the Treasury Department, I don't think we did well enough, and I don't think the US government does well enough, or the international community does, which is to backfill, which is to say, you can try to isolate bad actors and take them out of the system, but you need to deal with the externalities. You need to deal with those affected by this in the local economy. And you need to figure out ways of, let's say you close down a charity that is used by a terrorist group. What's the charitable backfill, right? We haven't quite figured that out. Or if we've said to a bank, stop doing business with a Hezbollah terrorist actor or somebody tied to the Taliban. Okay, that's fine if they stop doing that business, but what other good business can they do? And how can we backfill with positive economic tools and leverage and carrots in addition to the sanctioned sticks? We haven't quite figured that out. And that really does have to be a part of the equation to include active work by the government on humanitarian relief and the use of those exemptions that are built into the sanction systems to give people relief when they need it.
Right. You know, it's funny you mentioned actually the Taliban, because a lot of people don't appreciate or even know that the Taliban is sanctioned. They're sanctioned both by the United States and the United Nations. And I want to know, I'd love to hear from you what your thoughts are on how prominently you think sanctions will feature in the strategy to undermine the Taliban. Is it a good plan, or are there other ways to undermine the financial networks that they currently have, or that they could grow by now taking control of Afghanistan?
Hagar, you're absolutely right. Sanctions will again take center stage on this broader geopolitical, geoeconomic question as to what comes next in the aftermath of the Taliban takeover of Afghanistan, precisely because of the starting point. Your point is, yes, the Taliban is a designated terrorist organization. For now, two decades, been designated by the US, the European Union, countries like Canada, Australia, and the United Nations, which means, by the way, Russia and China are obligated to sanction and not do business with the Taliban. So that's a starting point. So the world has to contend with the fact that you have a known designated terrorist organization that now is attempting to control a country and all of its institutions. So the question then of who controls Afghanistan and its institutions becomes important, a question of authority. Who controls the central bank, for example? Who's operating the financial intelligence unit, which connects to others around the world? Who's running the embassies, right? And how can you do business with them, if at all? That becomes front and center. It becomes a central question of legitimacy. So if the Chinese and the Russians say they want to recognize the Taliban, they're gonna have to first deal with the fact that they're sanctioned, right? The Taliban is sanctioned. And the third part of this, Hagar, which often is not understood by those who just look at sanctions and don't look at the broader risk environment, it's going to be very easy for folks to say, we want to do business in Afghanistan. But if this is a Taliban-run economy, you have not just the risk of sanctions, but the fact that they've run drug trafficking operations, they're engaged in human rights abuses, there are questions of corruption. You know, there's a whole range of risks attached to doing business in Afghanistan. So the question of sanctions, illicit activity, will become front and center again in this geopolitical question about how you deal with a Taliban-run Afghanistan.
Right. I'm so glad you mentioned that, because I think a lot of folks think that this there'll be this like financial boon, and it's not exactly so cut and dry.
No, it's not. It's 2021. It's not 2001. And if you think about this, Hagar, you know, the world's talking about ESG principles, right? High-level principles on governance, social issues, environmental issues. How does the Taliban rank and look in the context of those kinds of standards? Pretty risky and pretty low.
Yeah, not a good look. I totally agree.
Right.
So Juan, you mentioned North Korea. Are sanctions effective? Because a lot of people question that when it comes to those sanctions or others as well.
A ton of debate on that, Hagar. My rule of thumb is look at how the targets react. We know that those that have been targeted, whether they're individuals, groups, countries, regimes, always want the sanctions to be lifted, in part because it's a black mark. But the reality is it has material impact on their ability to do business. And we see this time and time again. The lifting of sanctions is a critical issue for any of the targets because it's painful, because they can't access bank accounts, they can't get loans, they can't do business as easily as they would like. And it they do make it harder and costlier and riskier to do business around the world. There's no question when the US is actually implementing them and enforcing them, and if you're doing it in concert with the international community, they're quite powerful. So all I say is look to see what the targets are doing and saying. I've got stories in the book about that. And the reality is sanctions hurt, and if they're applied properly, can be drastically effective.
I'm so glad you cleared that up for us. Well, I'm so grateful for this. Okay, so before we go, I want to talk about your book, which is so awesome for the geeks out there. Please,
I pulled mine out too because of you.
I listened to it on audiobook. It is all good. Please get it. So tell us quickly first, let's start with, in summary, what is your book about?
The book is fundamentally about how financial power and economic levers are now central to national security and how that story unfolded after 9/11. And so that was really the core of why I wanted to write the book. I also wanted to tell the story of the Treasury Department and the key role that it has played and all of the things that happened in that post 9/11 environment that now makes Treasury so central to national security, whereas before it was an afterthought.
That's so true. I know for me, I was really personally very proud. I wear Treasury on my sleeve. I worked at Treasury for 9 years, as you know. And I just, it made me so proud, all the elements of this book. I had a lot of favorite stories. You know, for example, when you guys went to Afghanistan, how you went and that you were all buttoned up and suited up and that wasn't exactly the area you were going to. I loved your part about the tri-border region. The story about SWIFT, I don't think a lot of people know that story now. So I thought that was really cool, just understanding the behind the scenes. But I am biased because, as you know, I love Danny Glazer. I have a very special place in my heart for him. And I loved the chapter on the negotiations with North Korea and Danny's part. And it literally had me laughing out loud. So what are your favorite one or two stories in your book?
Yeah, Hagar, I'm with you. I love Danny Glazer, and he's not only a great colleague and friend and business partner now, but he's also a great character in the book. So I do think the North Korea chapters, which are the three chapters in the middle of the book, are really the great stories of the book. There's lots of them. And I love the story of the negotiations around the use of sanctions against North Korea. And of course, we've used Section 311 against Banco Delta Asia, not to get too technical, but the reality was North Korea wanted their access to the financial system back. They wanted their money back. And that was the price of entry for the nuclear talks. That was how important this was. And Danny Glazer was traveling around East Asia with that as his kind of mission and mandate. And I love the fact that in the same hotel, Danny Glazer was present and Daniel Craig, the famous actor, James Bond, was there. And when Daniel Craig walked out, the press ignored the famous actor. And when Danny Glazer came out of the elevator, the press swarmed. And to me, it's a great story, but it's emblematic of how important the Treasury issues were, the Treasury mission, and how central at the time in terms of North Korean nuclear talks, the financial pressure was. And so Daniel Glazer was the star, not Daniel Craig. In light of Afghanistan, just real quickly, Hagar, the opening scene of the book where we land in Kabul in early 2002 really is a stark memory because it was dramatic to be, as I say in the book, sort of traveling back in time and being there in suits and ties in a war zone, trying to figure out how we deal with the aftermath of the invasion, the overthrow of the Taliban, and how we use our tools and influence around the world to affect that. That was really, you know, I still remember that vividly. And in light of the Taliban takeover of Kabul, I remember it with a bit of sadness at this moment. But In any event, that opening chapter, the North Korea chapters, I think are poignant stories.
I totally agree. I love the whole thing. You are so right. The story about Danny Glazer being the celebrity is so poignant. And so it makes a lot of sense. So
yeah. And Hagar, if you pick up the book in hard copy, you'll see some pictures in the middle, which are great. There's a picture of Danny being hoarded by the press, tons of mics in his face. So hope folks enjoy it. And thank you for reading the book, Hagar.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for writing it. Thank you for your service. Thank you for fighting crime. It's, you know, it's the best thing. And we're all so grateful for it. And everybody go pick up your copy of Treasury's War because it's the best. Juan, thank you so much for your insight and for joining me on Oh My World and for being a glorious geek.
I love it, Hagar. Thank you for having me and hope your audience continues to grow.
Thank you.